Hello everyone, we're getting ready to look up today with a brand new Uplook video with a very practical top 10 list. You can like the video, subscribe, and make sure to ring the bell so you don't miss out on any of our future videos. Today's topic, 10 basic steps to ordering your life. The good book says that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, Psalm 37:23. But obviously, we need to cooperate. But on the other hand, we don't want to just lean on our own understanding either. We need some doable steps that the Lord has revealed in His Word. Paul was concerned we'd be turned away from the simplicity in Christ. Let's get back on track. Number one, realize it isn't your life.
That's a great thing to discover, isn't it? Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, there are six, what, don't you know? And the last one is, don't you know that you're not your own? You're bought with a price. Therefore, this is the big therefore, glorify God in your bodies and in your spirits, which are the Lord. We have amazing resources at our disposal. God is for us. Christ is with us. The Spirit is in us. We have the infallible Word. We have the help of fellow Christians. And yet, through all of that, we read, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and He delights in His ways. So what we want to discover is, what are the principles by which God orders our lives?
Number two, proving is better than prioritizing.
I have a message where I say priorities are pagan and have no place in the Christian's life. Priorities are based on human reasoning, and it's based on the idea that I'm smart enough to figure out what's most important. But when we see people actually working on priorities in the Bible, every time they come up wrong. So like Martha, thinking it's more important to be serving than sitting. Now the Lord doesn't say Mary has chosen the better part. It was good to serve, and it's good to sit. The matter is ordering it so we know when we should do it. So in the Scripture, if we think, well, you know, what are the priorities in the Bible? There are priorities, but they're all just the first thing on the list. Seek first the kingdom, preach first the gospel, go first to your brother. There are no second things. There's only one thing on the list, and that thing is for me to live as Christ. So it's Christ in the business, Christ in the family, Christ in the church, Christ in my personal life. Anybody can juggle one ball. I don't have to have this long list where the wrong things keep getting in the wrong place. So instead of having a long list, what we need is two piles. God's goodwill for me and everything else. And that takes proving. And that takes a spiritual person spending time at the foot of the cross and saying, is this what you died to save me for? So there are good things in the other pile, but they're God's goodwill for somebody else. And so that matter of proving, prove what is well-pleasing to the Lord. Prove all things, hold fast to what's good. Prove that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. This is the biblical idea. So all I have are two piles, and in this pile, God's goodwill for me, there's always time to do the will of God. The problem is we're garbage collectors. We accumulate stuff, and we have to do spring cleaning and decide, these may be good things, but God wants me to give it to somebody else to do or to lay it aside so that I can use my time with Him ordering my steps.
Number three, understand that you can't make time. It's a non-renewable resource.
We hear this all the time, I'll have to make time for this or that, but you don't. You take time from something else. Am I going to sleep less? Am I going to spend less time eating? What am I going to do less in order to do something more? And, you know, New Year's resolutions, one of the reasons that they don't come to fruition is because every decision is actually two decisions. It's like Mount Ebal, the mount of cursing, and Mount Gerizim, the mount of blessing. You make a choice, not this one, but that one. And that's where we sometimes fall down, that we don't realize this is two decisions, and I have to decide what I'm going to give up in order to do what God wants me to do. I think, you know, when we understand that principle that we're redeeming the time, we're the time is running by us, and we're finding ways to take that and turn it into eternity. We do that by asking the Lord to direct our steps, and as we do, we can buy up those opportunities.
The number four, don't be a wandering generality. Specialize in what God made you for.
Right, we need to focus on the sphere of our influence. Where people benefit the most from what we do, more than likely that's the area of our giftedness and what God has called us to do. So we need to avoid the poison of procrastination and the listlessness of laziness. As we read in Colossians 3:23, whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord. Be wholehearted in everything you do, and in this way God is glorified, and you have that sense of mission and purpose in even the little things of life.
Number five, make proper preparation for projects.
That's the old line that well started is half finished. And sometimes we have a project that we step into before we're ready, and then it falls apart for one reason or another, and we feel a failure, we feel disappointed. So we have two stories the Lord Jesus told about the king who decided to go into battle before he counted the cost, and the man who started to build a tower and ran out of resources and became the laughing stock of the town. What Jesus is saying, we need to think ahead, we need to make plans and preparations for what we're going to do.
Number six, divide large projects into manageable parts.
Yes, the Lord, when he fed the multitude, said, make them sit down in 50s and hundreds. So one section at a time was being covered, and it wasn't just this endless mass of thousands of people. It gives us a sense of evident progress. It gives us a sense of accomplishment and of not being overwhelmed by the largeness of the project. I had a friend who came over to help me sometimes around the house, and that's what he did. He was retired, but he'd say, well, I'll work 3 hours every morning with you. And he'd divide the project into 3-hour chunks, and so every day there was this sense of accomplishment. We did what was going to be done for that day, and the rest was waiting for tomorrow.
Number seven, have clear objectives and don't allow problems to deflect you from your goal.
I think if we have the long-term goals should exactly match the will of God for us. The short-term goals are small, doable steps that move us in that direction. And if we keep making progress, nobody expects perfection. Nobody expects to be the great man of faith Abraham tomorrow or the great warrior David tomorrow. But if we're moving in the direction of the will of God for our lives step by step, then we have little encouragements. And it's easy to get discouraged when we get our eyes off the end goal and we start to feel that the problems are insurmountable, when in reality many of them are not. We're just worrying about things that may never happen. And my grandmother, she used to quote to my grandfather, if he came home discouraged from an elders meeting, for example, and wonder, you know, can we keep going? She would quote him Proverbs 24:10, which says, if you faint in the day of adversity, your strength is small. So she would encourage him to redouble his efforts and to keep the focus. What are you doing this for? You're not doing it to feel good. You're not doing it to please people. You're doing it for the Lord. And that's good enough reason to keep chugging.
Number eight, consider not only your choices, but the consequences of them.
It's like a railway track. There's a little branching, doesn't look like much, but by the end of the trip, we can be continents apart. And sometimes people look at the immediate project and they don't think about where it's leading them. So encouraging our children in sports, for example, it's good and healthy and teaches them a lot of good lessons. But if it takes them away from the Lord and off into the world, and they become successful, the world begins to applaud them, it can actually lead to their spiritual downfall. So yes, we need to think not only about the actions, but the consequences that follow. That's both on the positive and the negative side. Asaph wrote in Psalm 73, "I was envious of the boastful when I saw the prosperity of the wicked." They seemed to be doing well, didn't seem to have any problems. And then he says, "I went into the sanctuary of God, and then I understood their end." And so by looking down the road a little bit, sometimes, for example, those who want to be rich, well, you know, the world is full of people like that who have this desire to make it in the world. But he says, if you want to be rich, this is a self-inflicted wound. It may start out well, but you may end up being pierced through with many sorrows.
Then number 9, stay on task, but realize that interruptions can be opportunities in disguise.
We don't want to be so committed to the task that we miss out on these divine appointments. So the Lord Jesus has been asked to go to the house of a little girl that's dying. He's on his way there when suddenly he's interrupted. A hand reaches out and touches him in the crowd. He says, "Who touched me?" The disciples say, "Everybody's touching you." No, someone was looking for help. And he pauses the whole process, and you know the rest of the story, how the woman is reintroduced to society. She who was ceremonially unclean is reintroduced to society, given the opportunity to give a testimony. In the process, it seems that the little girl dies, and they say, "Don't trouble the master, it's too late." Never too late for the Lord. He carries on and accomplishes the purpose. So if we're in the will of God, we need to have the eyes to see and say, "Lord, in the morning, if you want to interrupt my schedule, I'm all for it." And this is where this little phrase that James tells us, don't say we will do this and that, but if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. So a businessman, he's running a computer business, and somebody calls up and says, "I need your help Monday morning." And he says, "Well, Lord willing, I'll be there at 9 o'clock. And they say, "What does that mean?" Well, it means that the Lord runs my business. And if at 8:30, a homeless man comes to me and says, "I haven't eaten for 3 days, I may feel the Lord wants me to take him out for breakfast. And I'll call you up and say, "This is what's happening. I'll get there as soon as possible." Because the Lord gets to preempt my plans. And that's what it means, Lord willing.
Then finally, number 10, learn from the past and seek correction from the right people.
We don't want to keep making the same mistakes for the next 50 years. And so the scripture says, don't tell a fool when he's wrong because he'll hate you for it, but tell a wise man because he'll take it to heart. Zig Ziglar used to say, failure is an event, not a person. And when we realize that, a failure is simply a lesson to learn from that someone has charged me for. It's like a college class. And in James 1:3, we read, the testing of your faith produces endurance. So going through hard times, even failures, I've learned something. That's one way not to do it. But take it as a lesson learned and keep moving on. Don't take it as a personal failure, but as an opportunity to learn.